I'm a little climb on the furniture.
No.
Where is our little climber?
BC, visiting the kids.
Oh, really?
Yep. Yeah, they're away for 2 weeks. Yeah.
He made
must be nice, yeah.
6 or 8 dozen cookies.
So do you have time for
chocolate chips? Chocolate, white chocolate.
Maybe. After Christmas?
Chocolate with peanut butter chips.
Lately, yeah, it seems to be they've got these shorter weeks. It must be because they're already December.
Yeah. He's got all the scoops.
Yeah, they come out with the
scoops. He's got time.
They're all
good. You can get his own cookie sheet. I don't touch his cookie sheet. You make chocolate one with white chips. He let the ladies do what they want with them.
And I thought, oh, it's an
He had to make, because we had a bakery at work, the employees at work, the shop with the cop.
Oh, yeah.
So the policeman give each,
Morning, friends.
Morning.
And welcome on this fine gray morning where there isn't enough snow to have snowballs. Anna just came back from Thunder Bay for a lightning visit, and apparently they had enough snow for toboggans and snowball fights. So we're thankful to be in Southern Ontario in the Banana Belt. As you know, or you may not know, but Linda Nicholson has recently had a hip transplant. She is in Sarnia for the foreseeable future. Apparently progress is slower than she would like, so there is no imminent release date for her. She's hoping for Christmas. Reality says, maybe not. However, since we love her, I have here a card, and I'm going to pass it around. so that you can sign it, and then I will take it after her. And I'll start way over here to the person closest to Sarnia. And I have here in front of me, somebody just happened to hand this off this morning in my mailbox, and I did have time to read it, and it says, should churches open Christmas Day? And according to St. James Presbyterian Church and folks over here, yes! So we are going to have a simple carol service on Christmas Day. That would be the 25th, where Sunday coincides with the 25th, with Christ's birthday. It's going to be a simple service. We're going to pick four or five carols, and then Lucy May and I, who are probably going to be the two music leaders for the day, are going to open up the floor for you to pick two songs. If they have reindeers or grandmothers being run over, you will probably be refused.
That's good.
If they are so obscure that we don't know the melody, we might turn you down. But we're just going to have a very casual and yet meaningful service on Christmas Day, in addition to our Christmas Eve service at 7 o'clock. So lots of worship, but it's important because this is a celebration of Christ's Day, and we believe churches shouldn't be closed just because there are shopping traditions or going to the movies early on Christmas Day. What else was I going to say? Oh, yes! This Friday, 7 p.m., our own Lucine Petrosian and her husband, Roman Kosarev, will be having a recital right here at St. James. So I invite you to come out. There will be food, of course. It's Presbyterian. And some wonderful music of variety, I understand. So yay, so thank you for doing that. And I think that's it for this morning. But anything else I need? Oh, we're on to birthdays. It's also White Gift Sunday, so if you had anything that you would like to bring forward, you can leave them at the basket during our offering time. And as you remember, we were offering gifts to the kids for St. Clair College, and I think they're all here. So well done. Give yourselves a round of applause for supporting our time. And we're going to take a moment now to celebrate those people who have birthdays in December. Anybody have a birthday in December? Don't tell me I'm the only one. Oh, Stephanie, yeah, she's... And Eric? Oh, and Bev, too? No, that's just waiting. Okay. So stand up, be recognized. Let's take a few moments now to gather our hearts and minds as we prepare for worship. Let's sing together.
Oh,
And Bernie, can I invite you to go back to the Advent liturgy? Oh, he's already there. He's good. I apologize. I'm a little distracted. I will explain why during the message later. So I invite you to join me in our Advent liturgy. Next slide, please. Next slide, please, Ernie. Come down, O Lord. Tear open the heavens and come down.
We wait in peace. We wait hearing the voices of those who call for peace in the world.
Comfort, O comfort your people and reveal your glory.
We pray for peace and wait for God to come down.
And as God has blessed us, I invite you now to share your blessings with God in our offering. Yes, I did have it planned before time. If our children would like to step forward. So, do you like to have fun? Yes. What kind of fun do you like to have? One thing that's your favorite thing to do for fun? Playing on your iPad. Oh, okay. Yes. That wasn't the answer I expected. But I did, I have to admit, I had one answer I was looking for, and that had to do something with the words Christmas and parade. Anybody remember a Christmas parade here in Chatham? Does anybody remember taking part in a Christmas parade in Chatham? Was that fun? Okay, good. Now, do you like doing serious stuff? Homework, chores. At least he's honest. However, do you know that you can actually have fun during doing serious stuff? You didn't know that? Okay, well, do you remember we had signs like this on our float? I can't even separate them. One of those days. We had signs like this on our float. This is what we had. We had no more hunger and equality for all and acceptance and tolerance and peace. And that's what we were doing on our float. So the float was fun, right? Now, are these serious signs? So do you still think we can't have fun and be serious? Oh, okay. How about you guys? Would you say that we can have fun and still have a serious message?
Yes.
I think so. So, even though it might seem we're having fun, we can do good things with helping other people. Is that serious work? Say yes.
Yes.
How about loving our neighbor? How about treating others like Jesus would treat us? And we can do that and have fun still? Okay, so it's true, we can do some things. Actually, you can even have fun doing chores. Ever have fun doing chores?
Yes.
No? Oh, yeah. It's fun doing the lawn. Well, you can draw patterns in it and say hello to your neighbors. Secret messages to your wife. Or you can try to make perfect lines. That's me. But you can have fun doing serious stuff for church too, right? So let's pray. God, we thank you.
God, we thank you.
For fun.
For fun.
And for serious work.
And for serious work.
We pray.
We pray.
That through the fun we have.
Through the fun we have.
We can also do.
We can also do.
Your important work.
Your important work.
Of loving others.
Of loving others.
And helping them.
And helping them.
To know Jesus.
To know Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
And Evelyn, you are going off to class? Okay. I think there should be a prayer buried in there someplace. Or is it one of those? You go backwards? Before?
Yes, there should be.
Up the other way? I guess it's just, yeah. Oh, really? Okay, it is one of those mornings. I did have a prayer together prepared, but apparently when I uploaded the fresh slides, it did not come. So I will pray, and you guys will listen along and pray quietly inside. Let's bow our heads together. Loving God, we give you thanks for today. We give you thanks for this celebration of peace that we remember with the second day of Advent. We pray that you let your peace descend upon our hearts through your forgiveness and through your understanding and love of us. We pray that your Holy Spirit will flow through us and get rid of all those things that bother us, that upset the peace within us, and that separate us from you. And we pray that that same Holy Spirit directs our hearts, minds, and voices to praise and to celebrate you this morning, to worship you truly and fully as you deserve, to honor the Holy Spirit by allowing it to flow through us and teach it, and to celebrate Jesus Christ, whose birth we will remember soon, but whose life we remember every day of our lives. We offer these words in his name, and we say together, Amen. So I think at this point, if I'm correct, Ross Simpson, who's reading our scriptures,
a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness a sash of his around his waist. The wolf will lie with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious.
We're going to sing.
Thank you.
Second reading is from Matthew 3, verses 1 to 12. In those days John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all of Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River.
Today's passages are traditional passages used on this second Sunday of Advent to help us to understand the coming of Christ from the point of view of peace, of an acceptance. The Isaiah passage is particularly beautiful in the images it portrays of the lion and the lion lying down together. These images of violent adversaries coming to terms with one another and finding peace, and one even learning to eat straw like the ox. So we have this beautiful picture that's painted of a future, and we sit down and relax and we enjoy the passage. And just put the first slide up and let's see if one thing works today. Okay. There we go. We have this personal aspect to it. It says, "But with righteousness, God will judge the needy. With justice, he will give decisions for the poor of the earth." So the passage speaks to us in human terms, in these personal terms. And then it goes on, and it says the wolf will live with the lamb, and these beautiful things that we described. So it goes from this idea of a personal God who identifies the needs of the weakest, of the poor, and talks about his righteousness, that there will be goodness coming, and it will be from God, and he will do it for the least, and one can assume that if he does it for the least, it's going to be for all humanity. And then the picture broadens. The picture broadens to give us not just a personal God who is going to deal with our issues and who makes sure that the poor are dealt with properly. The picture broadens to this global view where we're talking about wolves and lambs and leopards and this complete upheaval of the normal order of things. So it's not just a personal God who's going to intervene in your life and who's going to make it better for humanity. This is a God who is looking at all creation, at all life. And there's going to be a whole new way of life where violence, where death and destruction no longer have a place. In fact, it's such a radical change that the animal kingdom will no longer function the way we're used to. The lion will eat straw like an ox. So this is a transformative, a beautiful passage. We read it in times of trouble. We read it when we anticipate the coming of Christ, who is going to be the one who ushers this in. And we sit back and we relax and we enjoy the passage. And we miss the serious bit. Because interspersed in these passages, in the middle of this, Ernie anticipated just a little bit, but still, here's this passage. He will strike the earth with his rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. So this isn't just a fun passage that we take lightly. This isn't just a smiley-faced meme that we put on our Facebook page to cheer us up and to make friends happy. This is a serious passage that says, yes, there is going to be a change. God's righteousness will prevail, but if God's righteousness will prevail, then the ones who have gone against God are going to lose. This is a serious passage. This matters. This tells us something about our God. Something maybe we don't want to acknowledge as Christians in the world, that there are consequences for our actions. If you do something wrong, somebody's going to pay for it. And in this passage, if you're the one doing something wrong, it's going to be you. And it's not going to be pleasant. Now, I know that this is a countercultural message in modern times. Nowadays, we defer blame. Well, it's not my fault. Way back when, about 70 generations ago, one of my uncle's brother's sister's butchers, who lived across the street from the baker, hit a neighbor, and that really bothered me. That's why I made my mistake. So it's not my fault. It's like generations ago. So we defer blame, or we avoid it, or we let it go. You know, we don't even acknowledge that we made a mistake, or folks around us don't care if we blow it. But Scripture tells us otherwise, that if we are to get to that wonderful, peaceful future where the lion lies down with the lamb and eats straw like an ox, we have to be held accountable. Now, this is a particularly brutal passage, isn't it? It's not a lot of fun to deal with this one, because there's no hope. It is a black and white passage. He's going to judge the poor with righteousness, but he will slay the wicked. But we are anticipating. This candle that we lit today is in anticipation of the birth of our Savior, of recognizing Jesus' birth. So things change in the 800 or so years between Isaiah and the coming of Christ. Because what Christ does is offer us an option. When John the Baptist came onto the scene to announce Christ, he invited people to repent. I think, do we have that slide? Is there another slide to follow? He hopes. No? Okay. Well, in our scripture passage, John invites people to repent so that they can make way for Christ, to make way for him in their heart. And repenting is an interesting term. It's one that we don't often get right nowadays. The traditional understanding currently of repentance is to feel sorry, is to almost bow, scrape, and grovel towards the person that we've wronged, to look inwardly, to drop ourselves down, to put ourselves down. But the actual meaning of repentance is to turn around, is to change, is to flip how we do things. So if we are repenting for our sins truly and genuinely, then we are turning away from our sins. We're going the other direction. And every time we repent and we turn around, we head a little bit closer to Christ's heart. Every time we make a mistake and we desire to repent, it means we have to acknowledge that we made the mistake. It means that we have to recognize what it is we did wrong. Oh, those words that I spoke to my neighbor in anger took the Lord's name in vain and hurt his feelings unnecessarily. There were ways I could have expressed my displeasure or brought my neighbor to account better than what I did. So, next time, because we've repented and our neighbor hurts us, well, maybe we think twice about how we did it. We use better words, better language, kinder language, still bring the neighbor to account, but do so in a way that doesn't cause them harm, but rather helps them. So with repentance, we turn away from sin, but we turn to a better way. Yes, there's still a forgiveness. We ask our neighbor for forgiveness. We ask God for forgiveness. But the key is the turning away and going in a new direction, in the right direction. And this repentance can happen as often as necessary. I mean, sometimes I think we must look like tops to God, because we repent and then we turn around and do the same thing over again, or something new, and we turn around and we try the better way, and then we blow it and we turn around and we kind of spin. But the important thing is that we keep trying. And this is the new thing. This is the different thing that takes us away from this absolute, from this powerful passage that says if you are wicked, you will die. Of course, it doesn't fully excuse us. I mean, John the Baptist asks us to repent, so we have to respond to our sin. I mean, it's a serious business. Sin costs. But God has made it possible through Christ for us to get rid of sin, because not only does Christ enter our hearts to show us that we are loved, Christ also lives in and through us so that we can know what the right thing to do is. So we have an example. So we have a guide who will show us what it means to do the right thing, how we can treat our neighbor that has hurt us, how we can speak to them. Christ shows us how we can heal, how we can work in the world for positive things. So in our day-to-day life as Christians, I think one of the things that we have, one of the points that we have come to as people of faith is that we practice faith light. We love Jesus. And Jesus is fun, and we have this image in our mind of a smiling Jesus who does only good things and miracles and saves people. Well, we forget the fact that being a Christian is serious business. Being a Christian is more than just a smiley face Jesus offering us platitudes. It's more than our just trying to be nice people. Because when we just try to be nice people, that's when we let sin go. That's when we let things slide. That's when we fail to account for our own sins. That's when we fail to hold others to account for the way that they go against Christ, for the way that they hurt others. Being a Christian is serious business, but it is joyful business. It's like I mentioned to Matt with the parade. We had lots of fun in the parade, but we had a serious message. Our very presence there, forget the signs, forget the messages that we were trying to get across, our very presence as a church in what has become a secular celebration of Christianity is a powerful message. It's serious business. It's risky business. And the reason I'm distracted today is because immediately following worship this morning, I'm going to scoot off to Mount Zion, Ridgetown, where even as we speak, the Reverend Donald Hill is preaching for a call. A part-time call, a 50% position at this church. But here's why this is serious. Here's why this matters. You see, Mount Zion, for the past, I've been serving there for 11 years. Can you believe that? I've been here, this is my 13th year I've been here. I've been serving at Mount Zion for 11 years. For 10 of those years, they've had the Reverend Paul Shaw as their stated supply. Now, when I went to Mount Zion, basically, I was colored red, I had horns, a long tail, and pointy teeth. And it wasn't me personally, it was It was their relationship with presbytery. It was their own internal turmoil. They were in a troubled place, and I was kind of the lightning rod that represented their troubles. And it has taken 11 years for them to come to the point where they have the confidence, where they have the passion, where they have the desire to strike out in a new direction, where they are going to go from a basically what Paul Shaw did was he stabilized the patient. For you nurse and doctor types out there, he basically took the patient off the road, set them to the side, and stabilized them enough so that the doctor can come in now and move them forward. So it is a risk, because calling even a part-time minister puts about a 10 to 15% increase on their budget. This is serious business. They are stretching themselves in a huge way in order to call this minister that will go from a maintenance ministry to a growth ministry. That will take them from simply looking inwardly, although remarkably, they did a lot of stuff in the community. I mean, they are present in Ridgetown. But now, they have been healed and strengthened to the point where they are ready to risk, where they are ready to move forward and to be an even more powerful force in their community. It's serious business. But it's also joyful business. Last night we had a greet and meet with Reverend Don Hill, and there was far more laughter than worry. Yes, we talked about the finances, and there was a worrisome moment there, and that continues to be an undercurrent. But the joy of being able to take this step to call a minister, to be able to say once and for all, we don't need a doctor anymore. We don't need John Jereen to be here because we are going to be on our own. That's serious business. But it's also a tremendous moment of happiness and joy and excitement as I look forward to the possibility. Now for ourselves as a congregation and as a denomination, we need to be willing to look inwardly to see where it is that maybe we need to take some risks, where maybe our denomination needs to step up to the plate and be more visibly, publicly, to repent of some of its own sins and maybe laziness or lack of forward vision. And it's up to us as a congregation, as local churches, I mean, we're not the only ones in this boat where we're struggling, where we're wondering what's coming. So there's serious work to be done. But we're also invited to do it joyfully. One of the great pleasures I always have is coming in from my office just before worship and hearing the buzz in the narthex and in the sanctuary as you talk joyfully, as you celebrate one another. So my challenge, my invitation to you is to find a way to take that joy that represents Christ's serious love. I mean, your joy is not because you are here talking about sports or talking about who's doing what to whom. Your joy is because you are like a family, you are friends coming together to share each other's life, to love one another in this place. And that is a serious bit of business. So my invitation is to take that serious bit of business, to take that love that Christ has given you and that you are sharing, and to find a way to bring it to our community, to make it even louder and noisier and more raucous, so that not just me coming down from my office, but our community can hear this serious, joyful laughter, so that they can know and feel the love for Christ that you have for one another in their own hearts. Are you ready to do some serious business, folks?
Yes.
Amen. We're going to sing. Please join me in our group. Oh, I need you back there, Ernie. Unless Ed wants to take over. Or do you, why don't you just bring me the keyboard? Okay. Thanks, Ernie. First slide, please. Please join me in our communion liturgy. May God be with you.
And also with you.
May God's peace be with you.
And also upon you.
May God's love be with you.
And also with you.
Together, let us know Christ's peace, the peace that passes understanding.
Together, let us know his peace and calm to our souls.
Friends, this is God's table. It does not belong to St. James Presbyterian Church. It does not belong to the Presbytery of Essex, Kent. It does not belong to the Presbyterian Church in Canada. This table belongs to God and to God alone, and represents every single denomination that follows and believes in Jesus Christ. Thus, this table is a welcome place to anyone who has been baptized and knows the love of God. This is the table that will provide for us throughout eternity. This is the table that will feed and nourish us forevermore. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the forgiveness that heals our hearts. Thank you, God, for the Jesus offering of peace in the midst of turmoil. Thank you, God, for feeding us body, mind, and soul in this holy meal. This table, where Christ's body and Christ's blood are represented before us, represents the forgiveness and the peace that pass understanding. This is the body and blood that was shed for us, the covenant that was made for us, the promise that exists for us eternally. This table represents Christ's love, mercy, and kindness. Thank you, Jesus, for inviting us to our Father's table. Thank you, Jesus, for calling us your sisters and brothers. Thank you, Jesus, for calming our racing hearts and distressed souls. This rite of Holy Communion is a physical reality expressing a spiritual truth. The action of blessing, sharing, eating, and drinking feeds us spiritually. This simple meal of bread and wine points to our spiritual unity with God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for showing us our human and spiritual nature. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for filling us with God's wisdom, truth, and grace. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for uniting us with our heavenly Creator in our first meal. Let us pray together. God of heaven and earth, God of light and truth, God of mercy and love, empty us of sin and self, so that you might fill us with your Spirit of love and truth. Let us release ourselves from our attachment to earthly values, so that you might bind us to your Spirit of grace, mercy, and kindness. Let us accept this of bread and wine as Christ's body and blood, so that we might know his everlasting peace resting within us. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, broke it, and said, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you do this in memory of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the wine and said, "This is the blood of the new covenant shed on your behalf. Whenever you do this in memory of me." These are the gifts of God for the children of God. Together we will taste and see that the Lord is good. Now I'm going to invite you to share in the communion meal, and the only rule I have is that you wait until everyone has something to eat or drink, and then I'll give you a clear sign when we are to eat or drink together.
Thank you.
This is the body of Christ, broken for you. Circle of clear juice is grape juice, and the outer circle is wine. Please rise for our final prayer and benediction. Pray with me. Thank you, God of peace, who makes the lions lie down with the lamb. Make our every action bring peace to restless souls. Thank you, Spirit of wisdom, who teaches us the way to go and to live. May our every thought be informed and guided by you. Thank you, Jesus, who calls us to set our heavy burdens before you and offers us the lighter load of peace that passes understanding. May our very lives bring peace and hope to our troubled world. Amen. Now may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the peaceful presence of Christ himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen. Thank you.
Take care.